new world order.
Those are the roots of trouble.
I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of election, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night, instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to tonight's live edition. It is April 18th, 2013, one day before the, I believe it's the 20th, no, it's got to be more than the 20th anniversary because it happened in 95, right? So, no, I guess it's coming up to the 20th, so it's got to be like the 18th or 19th. I'll get the exact date because my math sucks from the two filmmakers that are coming up, but it's close enough to the anniversary of the Oklahoma City bombing. Now, if not many of you people know, it wasn't just Timothy McVeigh that drove up with a Ryder truck filled with ANFO and blew it up and killed people, and he was a homegrown terrorist and blah, 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 hated the government. That's what you're spoon-fed. But what you actually don't know is that there were multiple bombs found. You don't know that there were first responders that actually went against the grain, we'll say, and paid for it with their life. We'll get into that and more, because the first segment, as you all know, is quick. But this is stuff that I, especially with what's going on in Boston, as of late, is really pertinent, and it's really important to go over. And instead of going over Boston again and again and again, I've already done it three times this evening, or this week, I should say, this evening, we're going to be going over the Oklahoma City bombing, which has been brought up many times since this bombing at the Boston Marathon on Monday. How many times have you heard McVeigh's name thrown out there by the leftist media, MSNBC and CNN in particular? So, when we come back, I'm going to bring on my two guests, James Lane and Chris Emery, two filmmakers responsible for one of the most excellent documentaries on the Oklahoma City bombing ever created. And if you want to know the truth about it, you need to go watch the movie. It's called A Noble Lie. If you don't know about it, you're going to know about it tonight. And you need to go to the website. You need to go get the film. I have a copy myself. Look, I bought a copy from them. I didn't ask them to give me a copy. I purchased a copy out of my pocket from them last year. Why? Because I felt, A, it was important that I had this physical documentary, and B, I wanted to support them. Go get the film, do screenings, show your family. I can personally tell you, and I'll share this story with you when we come back, that it helped change someone's view in my personal life. That film, A Noble Lie. So stay tuned. We get back. Both filmmakers, Chris Emery, James Lane, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back. Nice long segment so I can get into it with my two guests this evening. And let me bring them up and not waste any more time. two members of the team that brought us the documentary film A Noble Lie, Mr. James Lane and Chris Emery. Gentlemen, welcome to the broadcast.
Thank you for having us on. We had a great time last time we were here.
Thank you. It's first time on your show. I appreciate it.
Yeah, that's right. Chris, this is the first time for you, second or third time for James. And like I was telling James, one of the last times we talked about Oklahoma City just in particular was I was looking through my notes and stuff today, and it happened to be exactly a year ago today. A whole new listening audience. I mean, we have the old listening audience plus a whole new one now. So I want to take a few minutes. Let's introduce you guys really quick to the audience and tell them a little bit about A Noble Lie. So whoever wants to pick up first, start with a little bit about yourselves and then what got you guys into making the film and what it's about.
This is Chris Emery. A Noble Lie is basically a scholarly, very methodical, and very professional approach to presenting the official narrative of the Oklahoma City bombing occurred on April 19, 1995. Tomorrow will mark the 18-year anniversary since that tragic day. And we present the official story, and then we disassemble it with the facts provided by the Justice Department, the FBI, local, county, state, federal law enforcement, as well as private investigators and a whole slew of people that came forward, anonymous, some that wanted to identify themselves, to tell the story of what really happened here, or at least head people in the right direction, our audience, give them the information and the tools to discern for themselves what really occurred here. And it's been a labor of love. We worked on it cumulatively. Actually, there are people on our team that started within 30 days after the bombing, so they've been on this for 18 years.
Yeah, this is James. Just starting out, as an activist here in Oklahoma, we started, the local chapter of We Are Change, and, you know, we were going down to the memorial and trying to talk to people about, some of the official story problems, some of the questions that the victims' family members and survivors had. And, you know, as we were trying to go around and try to find a source of information on this, there really wasn't much out there. And so that's kind of, Chris was already had the plans for the documentary in place, and now the rest of us kind of came on board and made it happen. And it's just really grateful for all the people that we worked with. Without any one person involved, the whole thing wouldn't have worked. But the goal was to put these questions that the family members and victims had and survivors in one cohesive package. One place you could go and get the whole spectrum of it. And we were lucky that on the timing, lucky, blessed, whatever, however you want to look at it, because two of the interviewees have already passed away since the movie's been released. And, the brave men that had been there in questioning the official story in the early days and really kind of pioneered some of the early research. You had the Oklahoma Bombing Investigation Committee. They laid the groundwork for us with the final report. And then we took that 16 years of or 15 years of investigation there and then compiled that into the documentary.
Which I have to say, again, is like the consummate film. I've said this to you guys before. It's the consummate film on the Oklahoma City bombing. I mean, literally, you guys, because of your film, my father was on the edge, right? He was on the verge of, well, I don't know. He's kind of on the fence. I don't know about 9/11. It's a little too much for me to take. Vietnam vet. He's in his 70s. Really a lot for him to take. So, I don't know, about 6 months ago, one of his trips over here, he comes and hangs out with me. And he's hanging out. And I put him in front of my television in the living room. And I sat him down. And I put the movie in. I dropped it into DVD player. I said, I'm not going to even sit in here with you. I'm not going to talk to you. I'm not, because if I sat there, I'd be like, you see? I'd be interrupting. I'd be screwing the flow up. So I knew you guys did a perfect job without me, right? So I put it in. I said, just watch this. When you're done, I'll come back. I came back when he was done, and he looked at me, and he goes, well, I was on the fence until now. They did it.
Wow.
So you guys totally turned my father around and helped wake him up. So kudos to you two.
Well, thank you. That was the whole point of the movie, was to get that information out there and do it in a way that, like you said, the people that normally reject what might be considered a conspiracy movie, you know. That's why we put the notice at the beginning of the film that we believe in the intelligence of the audience to discern for themselves what is factual and what is not. We don't feel the need to lead them to conclusions or present conjecture. You know, we only boiled it down to the most provable eyewitness testimony and documented evidence. And I think that credible approach has really garnered a lot of support. You know, I've heard a very, very similar stories to what you just said. You know, people would come up to us at film festivals and screenings, and that's our goal. That's the goal of Freedom Line Films. You know, with our next production that'll be coming out in the next couple of months, State of Mind, The Psychology of Control, you know, we were thinking, you know, why is it that people weren't questioning the Oklahoma City bombing? What is it that makes people, you know, just unquestioning, accepting the, you know, authority? And so we really wanted to get into the mechanisms of control and covering indoctrination, propaganda, psychological warfare, and even some aspects of MKUltra. And we do it in the same methodology as we did with A Noble Lie. You know, we present it in a way that's palatable to the uninitiated. It's not meant to preach to the choir. This is meant to be a tool for you to go out there and help wake up friends and family.
And it does exactly that. And you guys have been getting featured at a bunch of film festivals. Like, we can get into the evidence about the bombing, and I want to get into that, but we have plenty of time. I want the listener to understand that this isn't some hokey documentary put together for YouTube, not making fun of any of those documentaries on YouTube. I've made a few of those myself, so... you know, I'm not taking a shot at anybody, but this thing is like a feature-length film almost with the quality. And then the way you guys put it together, like you said, it's not you or Chris or anybody else coming out and screaming and ranting for 2 hours on film. You guys literally went and interviewed people that were there, survivors, witnesses. And their testimony, I'm sorry, but it can't be refuted. It turned my father, who was on the fence and was about it, to a full-on believer, and he's now awake because of, you know, particularly because of your film. So again, bam.
Well, thank you for the compliment, Popeye. We the film festival circuit really took us by surprise, and James and Austin certainly could concur to that. From January of 2012, which was the first week, which is about 3 weeks after the film was released, through January of 2013. When we attended our last film festival, there were 10. So we averaged that out. We were getting invited to film festivals, actually officially selected, on the average of just a little over 5 weeks. I would have the artwork to update our Facebook page, and boom, we'd get another 2 or 3 invites. So our graphic artist done a stellar job with Third Floor Labs out of Tennessee. They were saying, what's going on here? Even our agent in L.A. is like, this is insane. We've never seen this before, in a good way. So out of those 10, we were selected as the Best Picture Feature Documentary in 4, and then an additional 2 as a finalist. So we were just very humbled. We had no idea that long, at the time of the release, it was 17 years on, that we would get the response we did. And it's been very, very humbled, and we're very blessed, and we certainly don't take it for granted.
And how are, like, I know you guys are planning on releasing the new film. Are you guys going to do the same thing? Or how are you guys planning on releasing it? You're going to do this the same fashion with the bold viral outreach, you know, through the alternative media, independent media, whatever you want to call it?
Absolutely, and that's been something that's worked, you know, very well on getting the message out to folks. I mean, it was something that we all learned as activists, you know, working, you know, in the streets and then networking with people all over the world, you know, through social media sites, taking the enemy's tools and using them against them. And, you know, those people that we met, you know, in through activism have become really solid part of, you know, being able to get the word out to folks. And, yeah, I mean, without the activist community, you know, this obviously wouldn't have had near the success it has. You know, we're going to continue to push to get into Netflix. You know, one thing that your listeners can do to help with that is to actually write Netflix and ask for them to carry the film. And that way, whenever our distributor approaches them, they're more likely to accept the film. You know, and that way, maybe even more people can see it. You know, that really is our goal. You know, some folks have asked, you know, well, why is it not free online and this and that? You know, because we are trained in the video demand areas. You know, not everybody's going to go on YouTube and watch it because, you know, maybe they don't see the value of it. Kind of like you said, you know, not to disparage the people that make the quick YouTube videos, but, you know, some folks won't take the time to watch those. But now if they've paid for Netflix and they see it on their Netflix account, you know, oh, well, here they are coming up on the anniversary of the bombing next year or something. You know, that might be something that they'd watch. We're real grateful for an interview that we're getting tomorrow with Russia Today. That's going to open up a whole new audience that may not have even heard about the film before. And, you know, especially people in European countries seem to be a little more open to these ideas than Americans.
To put this into context, Popeye, real quick, I was asked to put a list of all of the radio show hosts, the writers, and they overseas they call them newsreaders, some of the reporters, like for Channel 24, Australian Broadcasting out of Sydney. And then there's Miss Emery, forgot her last name. She's with Nippon Television out of Japan. But including yourself, we have a list of 71 media contacts, some commercial, most indie. There's no way we would have gotten the exposure without your help, of course, and all of your colleagues. And getting back to the Netflix, James was just interviewed by this radio host out of Hawaii, and he used to be in Japan, relocated to Hawaii. He's the one that came up with the idea of writing to Netflix, went on their website, took the initiative to get that information together. We're going to work on a narrative to shoot out to all of our contacts on all three of our Facebook pages and our Twitter pages, and we're going to expand on that and actually work with the social network and the social media even more than we did the first go-round. So we think it's really going to take off like gangbusters again.
Well, when you guys get that whole narrative set together and put together, email to me, and I'll put it together as a post on Federal Jack. That way it's up there. People can go read it, and then they can take the time to contact Netflix, however, and then I'll throw it all over Facebook and Twitter and everything else.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate awesome. That's very generous. Thanks, man.
Well, I mean, you know, you guys did a phenomenal job on the movie, and people need to see it. It's that simple. There's no other reason. Look, the only way we're going to beat these scumbags that pull off this stuff is if we all work together and stop, you know, it's not about making a buck. It's not about, oh, well, you're going to pay me for advertising. No, it's not about that at all. It's about doing what's right.
That's right.
So that way we can have a better world to live in, right? And then we can all be in a better place. It's about, you know, everybody wants to live in this, I don't want to say collectivist society, but like a better collective reality, right? Like we all share this collective reality and then our own personal separate individual realities. And I'm trying to make for a better one. And the way to do that is to, you know, help build bridges and do stuff like that. So yeah, I'll do whatever I can to help you guys, dude, without a doubt.
Well, I sure do appreciate it. And, you know, and then with the next film coming out, you know, I think that that's it's really going to be, you know, a good follow-up to A Noble Lie. We do plan on, you know, releasing at least one film per year going forward. We're not going to be a one-hit wonder. We're actually starting to collaborate with other film companies now that are working in a similar genre, and there could be several productions coming out per year as we all collaborate and help pitch in on each other's projects, either producing or whatever special skill set we have to contribute to their efforts, and then they help us with ours. It's a way to make, you know, truly independent, low-budget, you know, documentaries look, you know, the quality that would be acceptable by maybe a premium cable channel.
Well, and a lot of your listeners may not realize, but obviously there were other excellent filmmakers that had been doing this for quite some time that stepped forward and helped us out. There's no way we could have really got up to speed without their help. Of course, Alex Jones, William Lewis, I mean, it was phenomenal what he did. Yeah, he rolled out the red carpet for us.
Yeah, him and Debbie, I mean, they gave us advice that, you know, it put us, you know, months ahead of, you know, having to reinvent the wheel. So, yeah, very grateful to them. And we've tried to do the same thing for, you know, other filmmakers, you know, working on their first projects now. And so that's the kind of deal. Just pay it forward, you know.
Yeah, and of course, the team with Lou Change, all three of those guys over the years. I remember when I was tempted just to chuck everything I had into the dumpster. It was very disheartening. One roadblock after another. But if it wasn't Dylan, it was Corey. If it wasn't Corey, it was Jason. That we'd be at these different conferences, and they pull me aside and said, hey, how's the movie going? Always there to give the support. So we really want to acknowledge those guys and, of course, Alex Jones' team.
Guys, I'm going to cut us off really quick.
Okay.
Just hold on one sec because we got the brakes sneaking up on us. So hold that thought. Ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. When we get back, more on the Oklahoma City bombing. Stay tuned. All right, ladies and gentlemen, quick 5-minute segment. And we have a nice long one coming back on the other side of the break. But in this short segment, I want to dive into, you know, start to dive into the bombing. And then we can get into details on the other side in the longer segment. But first and foremost, for those of you that don't know, April 19th, 1995. And again, my math was off. It was 18 years. I think I was thinking of Waco as the 20th anniversary. Correct, guys? It's Waco?
Yes, sir. That's correct.
That's why I was mixing the two up. So Waco's 20th. Thank you, Chris, by the way. Waco's 20th. And it's the 18th of the Oklahoma City bombing. And it, by the way, I find it ironic, and I'll pick your guys' brains about the, you know, a little bit about the Boston thing later, but I just find it ironic how it's this time of year again, and here we go, bombs going off, innocent people being killed. I don't think it's a coincidence. And I don't think anybody else out there that's researched any of this does either. So April 19th, 1995, the Murrow Federal Building gets bombed by what the official government theory will tell you, or story will tell you, is a Ryder truck bomb, lone nut individual who was pissed off at the government, did it with an Anfo bomb, and that's that, and we need to pass all these laws, and they love to throw it up in people's faces now, 18 years later. Rachel Maddow did a piece, I think it was last year, and if that's on Netflix, then this movie should be on Netflix to be able to refute that garbage, by the way, because I know that Maddow's thing is on Netflix, I've seen it. If you go under documentaries, the McVeigh tapes or whatever, anyway, it's garbage. I wouldn't even waste your time with it. It's all, it all supports the official story. You want to see the truth, go watch A Noble Lie, and I'll have the guys tell you where you can purchase a copy of it in a second. But let's start with the bombing, guys. So the bomb goes off. You know, according to the official story, it was just the truck bomb. But there was actually more than the truck bomb, right? From what I recall, in fact, seeing in your film, you guys have video footage from the local news media of them, of the local bomb squad picking up other bombs, correct?
Yeah, and this is one of the most glaring problems with the official story, in my personal opinion. You know, when folks go to NobleEye.com and pick up the film, they'll find out more information about this. But, you know, you had survivors that were in the building, like Jane Graham. She worked for HUD. She was on the one of the upper floors, I believe 8th floor, and she was on a Windows 95 training class that day. And the instructor had time to assess the situation and respond to the class and told them, it's an earthquake, get under your desk. And Jane said she thought to herself, it doesn't seem like an earthquake, and then the truck bomb went off. So according to the FEMA report, that blast wave from the truck was traveling at 1,500 feet per second. Many, many people in the building had time to think about it and then get under their desk before the glass blew in. Now those two don't work out, in my opinion. And like you said earlier, I'm going to believe the people that were in the building, not the official story. You know, the people that were actually there, those are the ones that know what happened. And there was, you know, so many issues with that. You know, we had Brigadier General Parton that did, you know, some expert analysis on the explosives, and said that it was in his opinion that there had to be additional ordnance on the columns to bring the building down. You know, you've got the magic bullet with JFK. It seems like the Oklahoma City bombing was the magic bomb. You know, the crater is so offset from that large bite in the building, it would have had to have gone forward and taken a right-hand turn. Eglin Air Force Base, they reconstructed the bomb and found that the gaps between the barrels canceled out most of the blast and pushed it upwards. So they constructed a single larger explosive using ammonium nitrate and fuel oil, referred to as ANFO, and set it off next to a weaker test structure. It actually did less damage than we see at the Murrah Building. It was their conclusion that there had to be an additional ordnance inside the building. I mean, the list goes on and on.
I had a chance to speak with Carlton Armstrong. He was one of the four culprits in the Madison Sterling Hall bombing in August of 1970. And I met with him back in September of 2003. I had two separate meetings with him. I gave him a copy of the final report, which the Bombing Investigation Committee wrote and submitted as a congressional report. It's a scholarly piece of work. It's incredible. And 2 weeks later, I flew back up to Madison to meet with him. And we were sitting in a sandwich, kind of a short order restaurant that he had down in about four blocks from the Sterling Hall, ironically. And he took off his reading glasses. He looked at me, set them down on the table, and he says, Chris, he says, there's no way that Timothy McVeigh and Terry Nichols, mentally, physically, or financially, could have pulled off that bombing. He said it was horrendous. He said there were several people that had to pull that off. This is coming from a guy that was a convicted felon, one count of involuntary manslaughter, served 8.5 years of a 14-year prison sentence in a maximum security lockup in central Wisconsin. He knew that there was more people involved with the Oklahoma City bombing. So that is from the criminal side. And then on the other end of the spectrum, you have General Parton, and then, of course, Samuel Cohen, who we cite in the movie. So we're getting the...
Dr. Samuel Cohen was the inventor of the neutron bomb.
And hold, you know what, guys? Hold that thought. I want to get deeper into this part right here when we come back into the longer segment. So hold that thought right there. Ladies and gentlemen, do not go anywhere. And if you look up Parton Report on federaljack.com, you'll be able to see what I'm talking about. We'll be right back. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back. And I want to get back into the bomb blast evidence because now we have a nice long segment. So we were talking about the Parton Report and all this other evidence that shows that there's no way that an ANFO bomb, especially the ANFO bomb that they say that was in that truck, was able to cause the damage that was caused to that building. There had to be munitions somewhere inside that building. What about the ATF locker filled with munitions that they said wasn't in there?
Exactly. And then just to finish the thought from before the break, I want to say that he was talking about Samuel Cohen. It's Dr. Samuel Cohen, the inventor of the neutron bomb, and his official statement about the Oklahoma City bombing official story was that it would be against the laws of physics for ammonium nitrate and fuel oil, no matter how much was used, to do the damage that was seen at the federal building. As far as the ATF locker, there was a safe in there, and they said, oh, they had no weapons and no explosives or anything. And we've got the footage from the Sheriff Sumter. He had been on the scene with a video camera within, the early part of the search and rescue. And we've got footage of them pulling out weapons, It's like, it's ridiculous. I mean, how do they deny it? We've got the footage.
Yeah, they're so indignant, and they just, some of the people are just pathological liars, so we caught them in the act. It was amazing. Samuel Cohen had conferred with us several times on the phone. He was having some difficulty with his health, and he wasn't able to basically invite us to his home for various reasons, but he was very supportive of our efforts and gave us advice, just very open and very loving, and we were just very indebted to him. He passed on, I believe, shortly after the film was released. Incredible knowledge. Here's a guy who was 20-year, a protege, and he was brought to work on the Manhattan Project as a 20-year-old. He was a freaking genius. So between him and General Parton and several other people that have cited the report, there's no way that you could go against what they had to say. They knew what they were talking about.
Yeah, this isn't just, some fringe person just trying to do their own independent research. I mean, these were, credible experts. And, so we take that information and move forward. Like we said earlier, Chris had mentioned the Sterling Hall bombing, be it Sterling Hall, be it Northern Ireland, wherever ammonium nitrate and fuel oil has been used before, there's always been a nitric gas cloud. And the fact that that didn't happen in Oklahoma City, really calls into question what was the explosives that were used, it's a hallmark of ANFO. And Officer Terrence Shakey was on the scene within minutes. And he saved 8 people's lives that day. He had no problem with respiration. None of the survivors did, beyond, I think, some of the gasoline and tires that were burning on the, from the cars across the street. The other thing is all the debris. How does debris on papers and stuff from inside the building go against the blast wave and wind up in the building across the street on the other side of the explosion? Now if the building was blown out from the inside, well, that would make sense. Well, that goes in line with what all of the evidence and the experts say. There had to be additional evidence in the building.
We had a contractor friend of ours that knew of the cable TV company, Cox Cable, which is the local provider here. They had to go into the building directly north of the Murrah building. It was 240 feet from the front door to the south wall of this other building. And there was furniture, the blast wave from the Murrah building pushed all of the furniture, all of the file cabinets, to the far wall, another 90 feet away. He said it looked like a tsunami wave hit it, and that debris was piled up 7 to 9 feet against the opposite wall. Horrendous, horrendous blast wave attenuation. That is not a signature of ANFO whatsoever.
Yeah, and then, here we are. Tomorrow will be the 18th anniversary, as we've said. And, okay, so it's 18 years on. Everybody's been brought to justice, according to the government. Well, why can't we see the video from the cameras on the outside of the Murrah building? Whenever Jesse Trinidu, through FOIA requests and, various legal efforts, has tried to get the videotapes released, It was the government statement that it would cause a grave danger to national security if these tapes were released. Well, what is it that they're so scared of, you know? I think part of it is, you know, obviously every witness that saw McVeigh that day driving the, you know, in the truck saw him with additional perpetrators, including the prosecution's own witness, you know? You know, we know that there were other people involved, and we want them to be brought to justice. I mean, not just as, you know, Oklahomans, but just as human beings, you know?
One of the documents that Jesse Trenadu had was able to present to the judge in U.S. District Court in Salt Lake City in his effort to find out what happened to his brother. And, of course, as you know, Popeye, that segment of the story is developed in the movie. But what's really telling is one of the first clips that we have of Jesse's interview, just a brilliant interview altogether. We're very blessed to have him on there. He's saying that here's the members of the U.S. Prosecutor's Office out of Salt Lake City and the Justice Department and the FBI legal counsel are standing in front of the judge and saying, we cannot release these documents once again because of national security, but they don't want to reveal the names of the informants and the people that were actually involved in the caper that covered it up. They're more interested in self-preservation, which we developed toward the end of the movie, than telling the truth. To this day, they still do not want to release the names. They're not saying, hey, we're not hiding anything. They just don't want to release the names. So they're indicting themselves in that whole motion. It's very shocking. And there is no, absolutely no statute of limitations on murder. These people still have blood on their hands to this day.
You know, we've never seen the footage from the Oklahoma City bombing. We've never seen the footage from the Pentagon. We've never seen the footage from 7/7. And I'd be willing to bet that, you know, other than the local media and the independent photographers that have posted their pictures to the internet, I doubt we'll ever see the video footage from the cameras that I'm sure are on every light post in Boston, just like they are in every major city now. And I don't know what it is about that, but, you know, people seem to just accept that. It's like, well, there's video evidence of all of this. Why can we not see it?
Whatever company they buy the cameras from should be sued for the bazillions of dollars they've spent, apparently, that every government worldwide uses this one company that makes the crappiest cameras that never work, right?
Yeah, they magically just stop working whenever they're actually needed.
And, you know, here's another point. With the Boston bombing, because it's a special event, not only are they going to have the regular cameras that are affixed to all the poles, but what about all the portable ones that they roll in for these special events? Mm-hmm. And I don't want to hear, oh, well, we didn't have that type of security. Really? What's all this big Homeland Security complex about then?
Exactly. They've got those scissor lift guard towers that actually have the, you know, the cameras all over them that are integrated with facial recognition software. I mean, Danny Panzella from New York was telling me about that. You know, one of the protests they were there, that was like when they were really starting to roll that out in New York, and that was, you know, that was years ago. I mean, that was before, you know, the Homeland Security budget had really come into full swing.
I was getting geared up for a interview we had this morning, Popeye, and I got on the, if anybody can get on the website, it's open source, get on to the Boston FBI's field office of Boston, their website, and there's a press release, and I'm looking at a hard copy right now, by their special agent in charge. His name is Richard DeLores, and it's dated April 16th. I'm reading this. And it's almost verbatim a script of the press conference that I read from the morning after, or actually the afternoon of, the Oklahoma City bombing. These guys go by a script, and they just go right down the checklist. And all you have to do is just lift out the different names, put in different special agents, change the location, and boom, you've got the Oklahoma City bombing. Same narrative. It's unbelievable.
Another correlation is, you know, that the ATF and the bomb squad had been active the morning of April 19th, 1995, before the bombing. You know, people saw the ATF in you know, full gear. They saw the bomb truck driving around. Apparently, the bomb squad said they were running routine errands at 7 o'clock in the morning. I guess, you know, picking up their dry cleaning with the bomb truck. And then, you know, obviously 9/11, they were running drills then. 7/7, you know, this is a pattern we see over and over again, and we're starting to get information, you know, that there was possibly one going in Boston at the day of the bombing.
Well, when you see those guys, the pictures that came out on 4chan yesterday of the guys in the khaki, and everybody's like, are they SEALs? Are they not SEALs? To me, they look more like mercs, you know, private contractors, but doesn't matter. It looks like they were caught off guard. Like, to me, that indicates there was probably some sort of quote-unquote drill that went live, and they had no idea it was going to go live, because you can kind of see a little bit of surprise in the picture. It's not that you really get a good detail of their face, but You know, why else would they, if they were really black ops and spec ops, they would not be getting caught on camera. They're better than that. They're trained to be ghosts. That's why they're called spec ops. You don't see them. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah, they wouldn't all be wearing identical, you know, paramilitary garb. Yeah, that was my first impression of it, too, is, you know, some sort of Blackwater style, you know, XE, you know, mercenaries.
When I first saw those pictures, we had a lot of street actions here in Oklahoma City just to get feedback from the general population if this movie would even be viable. And right after the 10-year anniversary, I was applied and I was issued a 90-day street permit to hand out literature. Almost at least once a week, we would get military operatives, high and tight haircuts, khaki pants, Hawaiian shirts. I mean, it got to be silly. We could pick these guys out like a sore thumb. And they come up to us, acting as like common citizens. We knew that they were running intel on us. And we called them out on it and flustered them. And luckily, Holland van den Nieuwenhoff, one of our researchers, he's former Marine. He could pick them out. And so when I looked at these pictures, it's just, hell, these guys look like the ones who used to give us flack when we were doing the street actions.
Yeah, they totally, you know, when I saw it, I was like, first of all, you could tell, obviously, the way they're caught off guard, if you look at the pictures, if they were really running an op, if those guys were the guys running an op, but I'm not saying that they might have actually had something in the bags that was a real bomb. Remember, they like to do that to the unwitting people. They, oh my God, there's a bomb in my backpack. Where have I seen that one before? 7-7. But
exactly
right. So it's not that this MO hasn't been used before. And to me, it's like they probably suckered these guys in to whatever drill they thought they were doing a drill. You know, it's a live event. What better place to do a drill? And then the powers that shouldn't be make it go live, which this seems to happen time and time and time again. And now, you brought up a good point about Oklahoma City. You said that the same thing happened in Oklahoma City. And we already know that there were drills going on 9/11. I mean, you know, Vigilant Guardian and all these other ones. You know, tons and tons of drills. But with Oklahoma City, I'll bet you not many people realize that there were drills going on. We only got a few minutes before we go to break, but let's focus on that for a second.
It was either drills or it was a sting operation that went wrong. I mean, either or, you know, in the same fashion, though, some outside element, took it live is what all the evidence points to, in our opinion.
That would be the whole operation itself. That it might, even if it was a sting operation, it ended up going live. They allowed it to happen.
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, I don't believe that, you know, the rank-and-file bureaucrat, you know, knows, you know, is willingly going in and killing children. You know, I think a lot of times, you know, people are kept, intentionally ignorant of, you know, the left hand doesn't know what the right hand's doing. It's so compartmentalized. But after the event, you know, it does go live, they're all going to be participating in the cover-up to preserve the institution and their own, you know, self-interest. You know, that's an axiom. We will act in our own self-interest. And, you know, they want to preserve their pensions, et cetera. And, you know, I'm sure that there's a million ways to justify it in their mind as to, oh, well, that wasn't, we were running a sting operation, but, you know, it wasn't our fault, you know, even though their fingerprints are all over everything.
Yeah, somebody brought up to me last night and a few times since then, a couple of different people, different researchers and people I chat with on and off behind the scenes here have been bringing up Chris Kyle's group, his private little mercenary or whatever organization, private contractor. That's a nice way of saying merc. I guess he's got his own group of private contractors, and a lot of people are saying, well, maybe it's his guys. And well, you know, if you think about it, maybe that's why he was merked out on the shooting range, what, 2 or 3 months ago. You know, I mean, you never know. I don't want to speculate too much because you never know. But there are all these shady connections now. Especially, there's always been intel connections, but now you have all these private mercenary companies. I mean, I would assume that some of them existed. Maybe one or two existed back in the day, but now, I mean, compared from 18 years ago to now, it even muddies the water even worse now, because now you have black ops, intel, and this whole, you know, multitude of merc companies that are out there running around causing havoc that they can go select from now too. Now, I mean, privatized warfare, it's just crazy. And I know there's a lot of intel connections to the bombing in Oklahoma City itself, and I want to get into that. We have a ton of time. Ladies and gentlemen, don't go anywhere. We're going to get cut off by the break really quick. When we get back,
I want to continue with the Intel connection, and then I want to get into Terrence Yakey and a few other things. So stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. There's so much information. You don't want to miss a piece of it. We'll be right back. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back. And, you know, I didn't even realize it because the hour was going by so fast that it's the final segment of the first hour, and it's the final segment with my guest. So we're not going to have time to cover both the Intel community connections and Terrence Yakey. And out of the two, Terrence is more important than that. At least getting his story out there is. The man's a hero. So we're gonna cover Terrence Yakey really quick. If you want to see, look, there's not enough time even in a 6 or 7 or 8 hour show to cover all the evidence that points out to the fact that the Oklahoma City bombing was definitely, at the very least, allowed to happen, if not pulled off by the government itself. So you have to go see the movie. So before we get into Terrence, really quick, guys, again, I want you to throw out and plug the film and anything else that you guys have going on where people can see the movie, buy it, purchase it, do screenings, whatever.
Absolutely. They can go to anoblelie.com. They can purchase the film there. It's also available on Amazon. And then they can also check out stateofmindmovie.com. That's stateofmindmovie.com. There's no trailers up on there yet. Those will be up in the next few weeks. And then the release of the film will be in within the next month or so. But to at least give them a little bit of a synopsis about what the movie will be about.
That's cool. And when you guys release that, I want to have you guys back on, and we'll go over that movie. And
absolutely,
we'll dedicate a whole hour just to that. But since we only have about we've got about 3.5 minutes left, I want to get into Terry really quick. Terrence Yakey, why is he important? Who is he? Go.
Okay, 7-year veteran of the police department, first city police officer to report to the scene of the crime. He pulled out 8 survivors out of the building. He saw unexploded ordnance, to the best of our knowledge, in that building. He knew that the official narrative was complete bunk from the word go. And for 1 year and 3 weeks, he tried to get the truth out. 13.5-page report he submitted to his commanding officers. They asked him to cut it down to 1.5 pages. He refused to lie. He was harassed mentally, physically. His car and apartments were broken into. And on May 8, 1996, he was found brutally tortured and murdered in a farm field about 32 miles west of downtown Oklahoma City. This is a very honorable police officer, head of the DARE program, public relations officer for the city, and also the on the Vice gang and the DARE program. So well-respected, actually had the potential to play college basketball and go into the NBA, very talented athlete. We were able to meet his family early on, after I moved here to Oklahoma City in early 2003, to meet his mother, the sisters, the now 94-year-old grandmother. They still want the truth on his passing to come out. They want justice.
Yeah, your listeners can go to tytruth.com to find out more information about Terry. There's always ongoing efforts to try to get a real investigation into his death. You know, his death was declared a suicide. You know, he was found out in that farm field. They say that he shot himself at a downward angle with a small caliber weapon that entered through the top of his skull and exited through his jaw at a far enough distance not to leave powder residue on the top of his head. You know, I don't know how a person shoots themselves like that. In addition to all of the wounds that he had, and it looked like he had been drugged through the field, no autopsy was done. They actually go so far as to say that he was high on drugs and alcohol, even though the blood test, and they didn't do an autopsy, but they did do a blood test, showed that he had no blood, drugs or alcohol in his system. You know, to disparage this hero, you know, to murder him, to torture him, and to do what they did, the way they treated his family, you know, he had held back a lot of the information from his family, I think, to protect them. And then when they start asking questions, they tell him, oh, you guys watch too much TV, you're just paranoid. It was a suicide. Well, he wasn't suicidal. They said that he had never said anything about suicide to them. If anything, he had everything to live for. You know, he just reconciled with his ex-wife. He was on his third interview with the FBI. He just got the key to the city. All of these accolades. You know, it's just a tragedy. And you know, his family just treated us like family. And you know, so we just want to do everything we can to get the information out about his story.
He had a 4.5-year-old and a 2.5-year-old daughter. There was no way that he would have left those. He loved those kids. And he, like as James said, he was going to reconcile with his estranged wife and get remarried. And in fact, his sister was holding the wedding ring. She told us it was just tragic what had happened. Absolutely.
I don't ever buy it when they say somebody who witnessed something or had a theory about something suddenly commits suicide. I don't buy it, ever. Especially in Terry's case. I mean, again, how do you shoot yourself in the head without getting any powder residue on the top of your head? To me, that would sound like he was on the ground and somebody was standing more than 3 feet away from him, right? Because
he was 6'7", weighed 265 pounds. There's no way you were going to bring him down. You would have had to have two or three guys wrestle him down. It would have been a fight.
And while we don't know for sure, you know, some people that have analyzed the evidence says that it looks like a lot of his wounds were meant to invoke fear. It looks like he was tortured for information and then executed, shot. Somebody was standing over him and shot down through the top of his head.
And that's the kind of thing that these dirtbags do. Guys, we are out of time. Thank you so much for coming on. I appreciate it. You guys are true, true patriots and heroes for doing what you do, because really it takes courage to talk about this. Trust me, I know. I know you guys get screwed with from time to time. So thank you, gentlemen. I appreciate what you do.
Thank you for everything you do. I see Federal Jack everywhere, man. You're on it. Thank you, Popeye.
No problem, man. It's an honor to be fighting this fight with you guys. Ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned. We'll be right back with hour number two. Don't go anywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with hour number two here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye, from FederalJack.com. It is April 18th, 2013. Interesting twist in the Boston bombing story with the FBI releasing pictures of two men. Interesting twist. We'll still see if they raid someone's apartment tomorrow or not. We'll see. You know, like yesterday I talked about how I thought that perhaps it'll be a lone, you know, they'll do a raid on the 19th and they'll find a lone guy, blah, 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 blah. Maybe it'll be two or three people, a small group of crazy gun enthusiasts. We'll see. Now, obviously, I don't believe that, but I find it interesting how the FBI says don't believe any other photos that you see out there, only the ones that we released, because these are the official ones, because we're officially releasing them. Don't look at those other photos. You know, a note to the powers that shouldn't be, because I know you guys all listen, I know you record all internet-based broadcasts. Yes, they do. You can actually go look this up. Back in 2011, the FBI awarded a contract to a private contractor. I don't remember if they were... They're on the East Coast. I just don't remember what state they're in. They're somewhere here on the East Coast, if I remember correctly. But maybe Georgia? Somewhere here on the East Coast. Anyway, you can go look this up. Their whole sole job is to record internet-based broadcasting. So let me give you guys a quick clue here in this quick, short first segment. When pictures and evidence like that come out, and suddenly, which, by the way, they have valid questions. Those pictures do pose valid questions, right? When stuff like that comes out, when you come out on national television and you say, don't believe anything but what we're telling you, and you say things blatantly like that, perhaps you don't know, or maybe you do know. I would tend to think you actually do know what you're doing and you're playing a game, but perhaps maybe you don't. And that throws up a big red flag to most people. Even people that are only somewhat awake. Maybe on the fence. Why is that? Because you're coming out and being, do not believe anything except this picture. Now, what happened the last time you guys pulled that crap? A couple months back, remember? You're going to arouse suspicion. So it makes one wonder, are they trying to arouse suspicions purposely to not muddy the waters, but it almost seems like they're playing new games. Everybody always says, well, including myself, well, they always play from this playbook, which they do. But it almost seems like they're learning and they're changing up, because remember, there is this newer generation, this younger generation. Everybody tends to think that we're still fighting David Rockefeller, and we're not. We're fighting, you know, his grandkids' generation, basically. That's who's taking over. So they're starting to think outside the box. There's a lot of weirdness to this whole thing. Anyway, I'll get into the Boston bombing a little more, and then I want to cover some of the stuff that's not being talked about because of the Boston bombing, including CISPA. Better contact your senators real fast. Like now. Look it up, CISPA. We'll be right back. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. So, there's a lot of shadiness to this Boston bombing, and we need to keep tearing this apart and looking into it. And I don't want to keep, you know, going on and on and on and on and on about it, because until tomorrow, anyway, at least, I won't really know if or none of us will know if my analysis is correct. It has been tweaked a little bit. Interesting. I found some videos, including one from this, I think it was a lieutenant colonel, and if I have time, I might play the audio. I might play the audio tonight. If not, maybe I'll try to fit it in tomorrow. But he was talking about, I'll definitely get the name of the video for you before the end of the broadcast tonight and throw it out there so you can look it up on YouTube yourself. But he's talking about how, in fact, his name is Lieutenant Colonel Potter. I have it right in front of me. Yeah, the title of the video is "Listen to Lieutenant Colonel Potter, Please." Listen to Lieutenant Colonel Potter, Please. Rolls right off the tongue. That's the title of the video. Again, the name of the video, you can find it on YouTube. It is titled "Listen to Lieutenant," spelled out the full word, "Lieutenant Colonel Potter." Or you can just type in, LT Colonel Potter. I'm sure Google will pick it up. But the full title, again, one more time, "Listen to Lieutenant Colonel Potter." Now, I found it interesting, to say the least. I don't know to say that I can even verify that this guy's information is 100% correct. But what I'm going to mention, he's one of the individuals that brought it up. So you can go check the video from there and then do some research on it. But apparently yesterday, if you remember when the group of people mobbed the courthouse, and they said, no, we don't have anybody in custody, that was erroneous reporting. That was supposedly that was their one of the patsies or the patsy they were going to use and to blame it on. And he was quote unquote going to be a right wing extremist, you know, and blah 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 blah, and gun nut. So who knows? There's a lot of speculation out there. I will say that this is much better. The independent and alternative medias have definitely not gone as haywire as they did with Sandy Hook, so that's a good thing, right? In fact, impressed with 4chan, whoever out there, I got to give a shout out to whoever found those pictures and started doing the digging and doing the research. You guys found more credible photos than what the FBI released. And because of the internet, that is now part of the historic record, whether they like it or not. Too many people have copies of those photos. They're all over the place. Their method of control is falling apart. So kudos to you, ladies and gentlemen, whoever you are out there, the people on 4chan that found those photos and actually took time out of respect for the people that were hurt and lost in Boston to find out what was going on, you know. Good on you. That's how we're going to defeat this crap. And that's why they want to shut the internet down. Hence, CISPA. Now, so many people were like, well, I thought we defeated CISPA. Oh, no. CISPA's back, ladies and gentlemen. CISPA's back. And it's not happy. Okay? And it's not good that CISPA's back. CISPA's no good. CISPA is the internet kill switch. If you don't know what it is, you need to look it up. Okay, and I'm going to give you a little more information about it myself, but you need to educate yourself on CISPA. You need to take about a half hour, 45 minutes. Go actually do some research. Don't believe when they tell you, no, no, no. that won't happen. That's a myth. That's a conspiracy theory. I mean, one of the things, it'll allow police to warrantlessly search databases and things like that. So that's nice. That's nice. Now, how is snooping in my email or snooping in a database with maybe personal information, someone's personal information in it, how is that going to help prevent terrorism? It's not going to help prevent terrorism. Come on, stop. It does a whole lot of other things. Now, it's already been approved by the House. I know it has not been approved, at least this version, by the Senate yet, but I mean, that doesn't mean anything. They could approve the thing, and it could be on the floor within a few days. And then, or, you know, getting voted on, approved, and then on the president's desk, I should say, within a few days. So we need to, like, be a little bit concerned about this. This is this is something that really needs to be looked at more closely by the regular masses. I don't want to say brain dead. I hate using the pejorative term. Even the term sheep is starting to get used too much, because I was once a sheep to a certain extent. You know, a lot of us were. It doesn't matter why, you know, I never trusted the government. That's great. Did you always know that the 9/11 was a false flag operation, or that the Oklahoma City bombing? Oh, you didn't? Okay, well, then, shush. Okay? So that's why I stopped using the term sheep or sheeple, because it's kind of derogatory. And if I want somebody to wake up, the last thing I want to do is come at them and be like, you're stupid. You know, it's not healthy. And it's not conducive to a good conversation or getting people to wake up whatsoever. So I don't think I'm going to try to take that term out of my lexicon. A lot of the older listeners know over the course of time, change would be the correct term, but for not the fake change that you're told about, not the hope and change garbage, but real actual change. I try to change the pop culture-ish words, if you will, that have been pumped into our heads, or the words that have been misused and their meanings have been misused. I try to make my own physical effort on my behalf to actually notice that I do it, so I can change myself, and then if I can bring that attention while I'm on air, then others might do it themselves, and then we might not be so duped. And I'll get into word magic and stuff and in other shows. Anyway, I don't want to get too sidetracked. I want to let you guys know about CISPA. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit of information about it. I'm going to read you a couple articles and stuff, but first, I'm going to give you a little bit of audio. Let's check out what's going on, the latest with CISPA. Now, this is from this was an actual update this afternoon from Russia Today, one of their tech guys. He's actually, out of all the interviews I've heard and all the pundits I've heard talking about what CISPA really is, he's actually the only person that's actually broke it down to what's really going on, except for the fact that no one's calling it the Internet Kill Switch, which that's what CISPA is. It's the Internet Kill Switch. But anyway, I digress. Here we go.
Sharing and Protection Act has been approved by the House of Representatives. One of the congressmen evoked Monday's deadly bombings in Boston as a reason to pass it. Let's get some more details on this, shall we, and talk to RT America's website producer, Andrew Blake. He's been closely following the debates over the bill. Hi there, Andrew. This bill seems in a bit of limbo at the moment, doesn't it? What are the chances that it's actually going to get through or be blocked? Which way is it going to go?
Okay, well, you know, it did pass the House today, and it's going to have to move on to the Senate, and should these U.S. senators agree to advance it like the House did today and send it over to the White House, it's then up to President Obama to ink his name to it, and then from there, we have CISPA. However, just earlier this week, top aides for the White House actually said that we will recommend the president veto this legislation. So should it pass the Senate, there is this warning that the president...
Heard that before. The NDAA.
And will not sign it, and he'll actually completely reject it. But we have to keep in mind, this is a president who has said before, or his aides have said before, that they will do one thing and have done another. You don't have to look any further than the National Defense Authorization Act. The NDAA passed in late 2011. In that case, the president said he would veto it, and sure enough, he signed it into law. So there is a chance that these threats are meaningless and this whole thing is moot, but we're really going to have to see what happens in the Senate before we can actually take it from there.
So that means call your senators right now and tell them, no, they don't need this. They don't need this. The infrastructure, ladies and gentlemen, stop being panicked. The infrastructure is not hooked up to the internet. The electrical grid is not hooked up to the internet, okay? If they start hooking it up to the internet, there's an issue. Yeah, they might have a cable connection for whatever local cable provider they have, you know, so the secretary can watch YouTube videos or get on Facebook coming into the office. But the reactors and or, you know, the electrical system or, you know, dams or water purification systems and airports, they're not hooked up to the internet. You'd have to hack into their internal system. Even Die Hard, what was it, 2, the one where they hacked the planes, they showed that you had to hack into the internal system. Seriously, and that movie was a bit of predictive programming in its own way, but you can't just plug in, you know, hackers can't sit at their computer in their mom's basement and be like, that's just what they want you to believe.
Andrew, remind our viewers, many of which aren't in America, why this act is causing so much controversy.
So the CISPA, the Cyber Sharing Intelligence, I'm sorry, the Cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act, has come under a lot of criticism by its opponents because they say that it does more than what the authors say it does. Now, the authors of CISPA, they say that this bill will let businesses, private companies, Google, Facebook, and any internet provider, these companies will be encouraged to share information with the federal government that will be used to track down, monitor, and curb cyber attacks aimed at the United States computers. Now, in theory, yes, it would do that. CISPA would allow the government to have access to this information, and it would remove liability from these companies. But at the same time, critics say that it puts too much of Americans' privacy at risk and that the right safeguards aren't there. So, in turn, people would be sacrificing their privacy for a little bit of security, and the opponents of the bill say that the balance just hasn't been struck and it needs to go back and lawmakers need to try again to find a legislation that will handle these cybersecurity concerns while also making American people feel like they are at ease and that their communications will not be targeted.
Of course, the supporters of the bill wasting no time in mentioning the Boston bombings as a reason to pass the bill. Do they have a fair point?
It was almost comical because when the bill was introduced back in February, I believe, when it was introduced for the second time.
Here, I know you're going to give a long-winded answer, dude, but I'll give a short one. No, it has no connection. They'll just, like Rahm Emanuel said, use any, you know, never let a good crisis go to waste. So, you know, while everybody's emotionally hot, you know, at their peak, everybody's all upset, let's pass bills. Yeah, that makes real good sense. Again, go live your life for 7 days passing or doing nothing in your life, making all your judgments based off of emotion. See how well that works out.
Representative Ruppersberger, one of the authors of the bill, he said, you know, we can't have another 9/11. We can't have another terrorist attack. But if we do, we will pass any law that needs to happen. Sure enough, just a few hours ago, another congressman, I believe it was Representative McCall, not certain there. The whole story is on rt.com/USA. But another congressman, he actually got up and said, well, look at what happened in Boston. These were bombs. Sure, they weren't digital bombs, but the next ones will be digital bombs. So we need to come together for the sake of national security and do something. And that's exactly why a lot of people have problems with this bill, because the people who are touting it, the people who are writing it, are people that don't really understand these cybersecurity concerns. Another lawmaker actually said that WikiLeaks was a hacking group and they're hacking the United States infrastructure. This is also like an unfounded claim. So there's a lot of concern over who is coming up with this bill, who is supporting it, and what they actually know about cybersecurity. The incident this morning saying that, you know, Boston would be reason enough to pass a cybersecurity bill is laughable to many people.
We're following it closely. Thanks for your input as well, RT America's web producer Andrew Blake on RT there.
Never let a good crisis go to waste, right?
Well, because of the bombings, obviously, you know, a pressure cooker, he bought it on Amazon and he didn't pay tax on it. Oh, that's another one. Hold on. Hold on to your britches, I got another one for you. All-out attack on the internet from every angle. So he bought a crock pot online, a pressure cooker. He didn't pay taxes on it. Ooh, bastard. The internet's gotta go, and then we tax the hell out of it.
Disgusting, we'll be right back. We are back, ladies and gentlemen. Quick segment, it's only about 5.5 minutes here. I want to read an article or part of an article, or at least touch on it anyway. You're going to have to go over and read the whole thing. Vigilant Citizen. If you don't know the website, you need to go check it out. Just excellent, excellent analysis and breakdown of what's going on in the esoteric slash occult connections that you might not know about. Helps you understand things. A lot of people say, you know, what's up with Waco happening? You know, why did Waco occur around this time? Why did the Oklahoma City bombing occur? You know, what else occurred? Well, I'm sure you don't, if people, you know, look back and realize, just from, let's say, well, we'll go back to 1947, but I could also tell you a couple other things. And this is listed in this article over at vigilantcitizen.com. Again, if you don't know the website, you need to go check it out. Excellent, excellent website. Vigilantcitizen.com. The title of the article is The End of April, A Time of Human Sacrifice. Why do we often witness tragedy and senseless deaths during the second half of April? The list of violent events that occurred during that time period is simply staggering. Here are just some of them. Now, he's got listed April 19th, 1993, Waco. April 19th, 1995, the bombing of the Murrow Federal Building in Oklahoma City, which I just talked to James and Chris about last hour. April 20th, 1999, the Columbine High School Massacre. April 16th, 2007, the Virginia Tech Massacre. April 16th, 2013, the Boston Marathon explosions. April 18th, 2013, at this huge fertilizer plant explosion, which I don't know. I haven't seen any evidence. I haven't looked into it either, so I can't say that there isn't any out there. I just haven't seen any evidence to see that this thing, it wasn't a... you know, an explosion at a plant that was on fire. But again, I haven't looked into it. I don't know the whole details of it. All I know is that there was an explosion at the plant. I've also seen explosions at other fertilizer plants and at chemical facilities and blevies and stuff. Long story short, I haven't investigated yet, so I don't know. But interesting that it happened. And then he's also got listed that April 16th, 1947, a ship loaded with ammonium nitrate docked at the port of Texas erupted in flames, causing a massive explosion that killed 576 people. So it's just interesting that amongst the ones that are already shady, you know, the bombings, the Virginia Tech, Columbine, OKC, and Waco, then you have these two other ones. Yes, there's a huge fertilizer plant explosion and another ship loaded with it. Those two, I don't know. I'd have to look into those two cases myself. Again, I don't know the background on them, so I can't come out and say yes, yes, yes. But there's other stuff, too. What about the assassination of Abraham Lincoln? What about the Titanic? Oh, not many people know about the Titanic. Last year is the 100th anniversary. This year it's only the 100th and or 100th and one, whatever, 101 anniversary. I can't pronounce it. Anyway, 101, we'll say. The 101st anniversary. There you go. Proper English, Popeye. Proper English. 101st anniversary of the sinking of the Titanic. And I actually did, Steve and I, Steve Starr is a good friend of the broadcast, as you all know now. He's been on a few times. Him and I did a broadcast on the Titanic, which we wanted to do another one this year, but this whole thing with the bombing and everything else just kind of threw everything off. So we're going to get into, we're going to do another one this year with some new stuff, that some other evidence that Steve has stumbled upon and stuff. And we'll get into that probably next month or whenever, because there's just so much. Which, by the way, you need to go research. You can go see, there's 1, 2, 3 interviews we've done now, or 3 broadcasts we've done, I should say, covering the Titanic. And then we've done one covering Abraham Lincoln. You can see them on, they're all linked up on my archive channel over on federaljack.com. But anyway, all this stuff happens around the same time period, right? The Lincoln assassination, again, the sinking of the Titanic, all these bombings, these shootings, and people want to know why. Now, I said that I've been saying this all week when people have been asking me this, and I said this on air a couple times, it is that time of the year. Like the middle of April to the end of April, up to like the beginning, I would say about the 5th of May, is when these guys have this like sick fetish for killing and having chaos and mayhem. Remember, May 1st is known as May Day for a reason. It's bad. Okay? It's the birth date of the Bavarian Illuminati, May 1st, 1776. It's right around the corner. Why does all this stuff fall into this time period? Well, I'll get into that a little more on the other side, so don't go anywhere. Stay tuned. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back. And some of the stuff I'm going to mention coming up here that I'm going to talk about here, I get into further detail. If you go into my archives, I've had a guest on before, and I will be having him on again. And I also have some stuff that I'm going to re-air here for Unbound that I've done with him in the past for the newer listeners, which I think is very important. But if you go in my archives, you can see some of the stuff I've done with him. His name's Mark Passio. And Mark is a good friend of mine, researcher. And I think it's actually this weekend. The Free Your Mind Conference. It's coming up. It's this month, I believe. I think it's this weekend. Tomorrow and maybe today, tomorrow and Sunday in Philadelphia. I would check it out if, not today because today's the 18th, but tomorrow, the 19th, the 20th, and the 21st. So Friday, Saturday, Sunday, I think it's this weekend if I remember correctly. Just Google Free Your Mind Conference 2. And if you're in the Philadelphia area or you just want to go on a quick day trip or whatever, and you want to go out there and check it out, I would definitely check it out because it's going to be worth your while. Just great, great speakers at the conference. Really, you're going to be blown away by the list. People like Kathy O'Brien, which you'll hear me mention her on broadcasts in the past, my older listeners or anybody that listens to the archived shows, you'll hear me bring her up again. Just a multitude of other speakers. There's going to be, I can't even remember all the people. Fritz Springmeier is going to be there. Just a ton of different speakers. Mark Passio is going to be speaking. All these other people on different topics. Mind control, the esoteric stuff. Anyway, if you go and you look in the archives and you look at my shows, I believe it was from last year, Halloween, the Halloween broadcast that there was. So I think it was the 28th because I wasn't on air at the time on Halloween that last year. So we'll say, if I remember correctly, it was the 28th. Go back and look in the archives, October 28th of 2000 and either 2012 or 2011. All right, go back and look. Either one of the two. Okay, it was either 2012 or 2011. I can't remember which year. I've done a lot of broadcasts. Anyway, you'll see. It'll say Mark Passio on the occult and all that. Listen to that broadcast because in that broadcast we really, really get into some of the stuff, including this date to this time period. And all the different Mark goes into detail, but all these different ceremonies and stuff that go on, and all these different rituals and things that go on, not only here throughout the country, but throughout the world. If you don't believe in Satanism, okay, if you don't believe that this stuff is real, well, I'm sorry, but it is. And it's not the stuff of emo kids, they spray paint some stuff in abandoned houses and smoke pot and worship. No, 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 no. That's not what's going on. It's way more sinister. I interviewed Fritz Springmeier in November of 2012 of this past year. You can see it in my archives. I'm going to have Fritz on again coming up soon. And if you listen to the interview, he goes into detail. Detail when we go into Satanism. He talks about how he's interviewed people that police officers that were they witnessed and had to shoot people that were involved in a satanic cult that were about to execute children or sacrifice them to their in their orgy of death that they love to do on their little altar to their Lord Satan. It's disgusting. Now, I mean, whatever, that's their, I mean, it's that's their religion. And human sacrifice, by the way, goes back throughout the ages, throughout different cultures. So it's not like it's anything out of the, people wouldn't do that to one another. Yeah, only in the movies, right? Okay, I keep believing that. Anyway, it doesn't really matter what you believe. It doesn't matter if you believe in this and you say, well, I don't even believe in God. Okay, that's great. I don't believe in the devil. That's great. Or you could say, well, I don't believe in that stuff, Popeye. I don't believe in magic or any of that. Well, I'm not asking you to believe in Harry Potter-type magic. I'm asking you to understand that these people believe that they worship whatever it is, demons, lizards from some other friggin' dimension, according to some. I don't care what you call them. They could be aliens, lizards, demons. I don't care. Whatever it is that they worship, it's evil, okay? And it drives these people to do evil things. And there's a lot of it goes way deeper, and I don't want to get too sidetracked on it. Again, you have to listen to the whole broadcast from the 28th, 10/28. It's in my archives with Mark Passio. During the break, I'll look up the year, and that way I can give you guys the exact date to go back and look in the archives. But I want to read you a little bit about this. I want to read you a little bit from this article. So this is from the article on Vigilant Citizen, again titled "The End of April, A Time of Human Sacrifice." I suggest you go read it. Here we go. There were many other violent occurrences that happened during that time period. In fact, CNN published an article in 2011 entitled "What Is It About Mid-April and Violence in America?" discussing the events that occurred in mid-April. Sadly, the article only bashed, quote, conspiracy theorists, and basically said, if you look for answers further than mass media, you are crazy and potentially dangerous. However, 2 years later, the same violent trend is going on. Is it all a coincidence? For those in the know, there is no such thing as coincidences. In 2011, I wrote an article about the death of bin Laden, which was announced between April 30th and May 1st. See why the death, and this is the title of the article, and the title of it is, Why the Death of a Man Who Was Not Behind 9/11 Was Announced on May 1st. In that article, I briefly described the ritualistic significance of May 1st, May Day, as I mentioned earlier, and its relation to a god that is still important for the occult elite, Baal. Now, Mark and I got into this in this broadcast. In fact, I actually deem it so important, and I know that not everybody's going to go back into my older archive. And if, for those of you who don't know where it is, it's over on federaljack.com. I have an archive page there, and everything is listed there, oldest to newest at the bottom. But I'm going to have to I know I'm going to be having Mark on again eventually as a guest, but he's super busy right now with this conference going on. So I'm going to dig that broadcast out of my archives, and I'm going to edit it up so I can play it for you guys here, because that broadcast is that important. It was actually a commercial-free one I did, if I remember correctly, so it shouldn't be that hard. But I'm going to bring that interview back to the airways again for the listeners, because Mark and I went into detail about Baal and all of this stuff. And then if you go back and you look at my archives from September of last year, September of 2012, we also did an episode about 9/11 and the occult significances there. You know what? I'm going to bring both of them out of the archives, because they're both commercial-free broadcasts I did with him. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to dig them out of the archives for you guys. Now that I think about it, my brain's just firing now. And in the next week, because it's significant, so within the next week, I will dedicate two broadcasts to that. I will get them edited up and ready to go over the course of the weekend for everybody, because it's that important that you all hear them. It really is, and they won't be it won't be the broadcast is pre-recorded. I'll be live, but I'll be playing it, coming in and out of the breaks for you. And unfortunately, it's going to be so long that I'm sure I won't even be able to fit the whole thing into the 2 hours that I'm allotted here on Unbound. But I will I'll play what I can get in, and then I will get I'll tell everybody where they can just go download the full archive again anyway, which you can just download them all now if you want, over at the federaljack.com archives. But again, I'll keep throwing it out there, because this information needs to be put across the airwaves. People need to hear it. It needs to be told, because the question keeps coming up now, because people are starting to notice that this repeat occurrence. And I got this question asked to me a lot in the past couple of days. Why does it keep happening? Well, Baal is why it keeps happening. Why do you pay bail when you go and you have to get yourself out of prison? How do you get yourself out? You bail your way out, right? Why do you think there's the image of a bell? Bell, Baal, hidden right in your face, right in plain sight. And there's more to it with the bell and other things, too. Ladies and gentlemen, there's so much esoteric stuff, okay? There's so much that's right in front of your face, and you don't even realize it. We need to learn this stuff. You need to educate yourself. And there's nothing, by the way, that I could get across to you in 2 hours that would educate you fully on this. You need to educate yourself. To quote the article, the cult of Baal never disappeared. Throughout many centuries and across many civilizations, the second half of April has always been a time of blood sacrifice. The worship of Baal took many names. Enlil, Molech, etc. Molech sound familiar, ladies and gentlemen? Bohemian Grove, anyone? And it spread across several civilizations. Being a sun god and a god of fertility, rituals celebrating Baal took place after the vernal equinox, a time of rebirth, and often involved human sacrifice. Well, the vernal equinox is the beginning of spring, right? The beginning of fertility and everything. Well, comes the human sacrifice. Although the observance of these rituals was sometimes condemned by religious movements, it never truly disappeared. As a sun god, Baal's worship involved human sacrifice and fire. Sound familiar? Oklahoma City, Waco, the bombings. I'll repeat that. As a sun god, Baal's worship involved human sacrifice and fire. Today, in the occult elite-ruled America, this time period often equals fire or gunfire and death. These rites were mentioned in the Bible. Quote, they have built in the high places of Baal to burn their children in the fire as offerings to Baal, something I did not command or mention, nor did it enter my mind. End quote. Jeremiah 19:5. From the Babylonian, Assyrian, and Phoenician civilizations of the Middle East, and this is where their mystery religions come from, the same origin over there, the cult of Baal spread to distant civilizations such as the Celts, who observed Beltane rituals on May 1st. Beltane originates from the word Baal. While the observance of Baal rituals differed from one civilization to another, they were nevertheless grounded in the same occult concepts of numerology and sacrifice. In other words, they were all tapping into the same magical knowledge. Today's occult elite still observes these rites, but with one major difference. They are now carried out on unsuspecting civilians and are spread across the world through mass media. Fed and amplified by the fear and trauma of the masses, these mega rituals are seen by all, but only celebrated by the occult elite. More than ever, we are dealing with black magic. Other sites dedicated to occult numerology have published information emphasizing the importance of this time period. Quote, April 19th to May 1st, blood sacrifice to the beast, most critical 13-day period, fire sacrifice is required on April 19th. April 19th is the first day of the 13-day satanic ritual relating to fire. The fire god Baal, or Molech, / Nimrod, the sun god, also known as the Roman god Saturn, Satan, or the devil, this day is a major human sacrifice day, demanding fire sacrifice with an emphasis on children. This day is one of the most important human sacrifice days, and as such, has had some very important historic events occur on this day. End quote. Occult holidays and Sabbaths, cutting edge. Another article briefly describes the elements required to carry out the elite's mega rituals, but I will get into that in the final segment. And I'll get the exact date of that interview that I was referencing with Mark Passio for you all to go listen to. And I will, again, play it on air anyway, but I'll get the date for you to download it if you are interested. So stand by. We will be right back. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. Final segment. Man, tonight's 2 hours just flew right by. We shall see what happens in the next 24 hours, if they have some sort of blood sacrifice, if they do the raid on these guys tomorrow, and, you know, perhaps they'll be two, three, maybe four of them. Maybe it'll be a, instead of a lone gunman, it'll be a lone little group of whatever. I'm sure they'll blame them right-wingers or whatever, and I'm sure if they raid them, they'll never be caught alive. I'm sure they're going to, quote-unquote, go down in a blaze of glory. Right. There will never be any trial of these guys, ever. If there is, I'll be surprised. And if they catch them alive, like Oswald, they won't make it to trial. So anyway, I want to read you the conclusion of this really quick, because we only got a few minutes. So here's the conclusion of the article, but you can go read the full article again over at vigilantcitizen.com. Excellent, excellent website. Bookmark it. The guy has a great insight into what's going on. He really does. I use it for reference material. In conclusion, those who know about occult calendars enter the second half of April wondering if something horrific is about to happen. Sadly, every few years, the public is traumatized with a senseless and violent event. Almost every time, a closer look at the event leads to strange, suspicious facts and hints towards an inside job. While many will ascribe the occurrence of these events during the end of April to coincidence, the fact remains. Violent events involving death and fire happened during the same time period that was dedicated to Baal, through fire and human sacrifice. Whether this is all done on purpose or is the result of crazy synchronicity, the fact is still there and cannot be disputed. The compound that was burned down during the 1993 Waco massacre was named Mount Carmel Center. In the Bible, Mount Carmel was where Elijah defied prophets of Baal, challenging them to pray to Baal until he lit a fire in front of them. No fire was lit. Was the fire at Mount Carmel Center a symbolic revenge of Baal? And that's where he leaves it. And ladies and gentlemen, you need to understand this deeper. That's why it is super important. I am going to actually, like I said, next week, because tomorrow I have, I'm not going to have time. Maybe if I have time, but tomorrow I have a bunch of other things I want to get into. Plus, we're going to see what goes on during the day. But definitely next week, I'm going to play, if I can get it done and edit it up for you guys tomorrow, maybe I'll get it all up tomorrow, but you can go see the, or hear the full interview I did with Mark Passio. It's uninterrupted, commercial free, up at my archive channel on federaljack.com. Just go to my website, federaljack.com, right on the side. There's a down the rabbit hole with Popeye archive section. I was right. It was 2011. So it's 10/28 of 2011. And the title is Mark Passio, The Dark Occult, Satanism, and More. Now, for those of you that don't go listen to it, or because it's on the version that's up there is on YouTube. So if you don't want to listen to it on YouTube or whatever, I will re-air that broadcast I did with Mark next week. In fact, if I have time, I have to look on the schedule, but I'll have to check. I'll try to get it done if I can get it together and nothing major, you know, happens with this whole thing. Tomorrow I will, with the Boston bombing thing and anything else, I'll try to get it together tomorrow. If not, I'll re-air it sometime next week, definitely Monday then, because this stuff is of the utmost importance for people to understand, especially while this stuff is all going on and people are going, I don't understand. It's this whole time period from the middle of April until May 1st. These people are evil. Evil, sick, sociopaths. And they still worship Baal. And that's the way it is. I know some people don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that. It's too crazy. Really? Look around you. You don't think it's crazy already? They really do worship this. They worship Baal. Whether or not it's real or not, that's what they believe in. Doesn't matter what you believe in, ladies and gentlemen. It matters what the sociopaths that are lighting off bombs during marathons believe in. It matters what the sociopaths that light off bombs and demolish buildings and crush little children, like in the Oklahoma City bombing. It matters what they believe in, because they're the ones doing this horrific crap. So it does matter what they believe in. Doesn't matter if you don't believe it, you know, that's great. You don't have to believe in it. But you have to understand the fact that they do. You have to know your enemy, or you stand no chance of winning. With that, ladies and gentlemen, we are out of time. You can email me questions, comments, vfor911@gmail.com, vfor911@gmail.com. One more time, v for 911@gmail.com, v, the letter v, for911@gmail.com.
This is Sparta!
And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we're out of time, and I'm out of here until tomorrow night. Stay vigilant. Stay strong. The solutions to our problems are an inside job. I love you all.